Glad you guys are here tonight. I'm excited for you. God's going to do a good work. Amen. All right. So tonight we're going to talk about practical ways to obtain miracles. Amen. Who needs a miracle in their life?
Everybody.
Everybody. Amen. I do. We all need miracles. Amen. So we just want to get practical and keep it simple tonight and just show you where, how simple it is in the kingdom of God to get your miracle. Amen. Praise God. I want you guys to repeat after me. Say, I'm ready, Lord.
I'm ready, Lord.
I want my miracle tonight, Lord.
I want my miracle tonight, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
Yes. Amen. Amen. I love confessions. Amen. So Jeremiah 32:27 is a wonderful promise. Amen. Behold, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh. Is there anything too hard for me? Amen. And so we know that every circumstance and every situation is different for everybody. Amen. And we all, in our own minds, we think, man, I'm in the worst situation here. We think that it's worse than anybody else, and that it's going to take, you know, angels and the whole a prayer chain across the world. But God is telling us tonight, is there anything too hard for me? Amen? And the answer is no. Their answer is that there is nothing too hard for God to do for us. Amen? That He wants to answer our prayers. Amen? That God wants us to obtain that miracle that we've been praying for. That God will answer us. God does want to bless us and heal us and transform us and do His work in our lives. Amen. Do you believe it? Jesus said in John chapter 4, verse 4, I must work the works of Him that sent me while it is day. The night cometh when no man can work. Amen. So we know that Jesus is at work in our lives. Amen. Do you believe it? Amen. Jesus Christ is at work in your life. Amen. So I want you to say this with me. Say, Jesus is at work in my life. Jesus Christ is at work in your life, and he's in the background. You cannot see Jesus Christ. Amen. He's unseen, and He's at work in your life. That's why He brought you here. That's why He's working some things out in your life. That's why you're being convicted in this area. That's why that person, that's why God has closed that door for that relationship. And that's why God has done this. And that's why God has opened a new opportunity for your career. And God is at work. Amen. God is at work. Hallelujah. And He wants to answer us tonight and give us that long-awaited miracle that we need. Amen. Let's pray. Father, thank you for for the beautiful church in the house tonight. Father, I pray that you would tonight reveal Jesus Christ in a mighty way. And I pray that tonight that we would obtain the miracles that we've been praying for, God. And I thank you for what you're going to do. And I thank you that it is your will that everybody in this place be blessed tonight for the glory of Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name, amen. Praise God. So number one, once again, we're going to discuss practical keys to receiving miracles. Number one, God is with you. Amen. God is with us. Amen. We have no reason to doubt God. Amen. We have no reason to doubt God. We have confidence now. We should have confidence now. Amen. We should have great confidence in the living God. Amen. We ought to have great confidence in God's word, and we ought to have great confidence in God. Amen. Amen. We should have joy. We should have courage and boldness now. We ought to have Holy Ghost boldness in God. Amen. In His work, in His word, in His name, in what He's doing for you, in what He's doing for your children and your family and your husband, in what He's doing for your finances, in what He's doing for your emotions, in what He's doing for your soul, in what He's doing for your mind, in what He's doing for every area of your life. Amen. God is at work. God is doing it. Amen. We have this great self-esteem now. We have a godly self-esteem. Amen. We don't feel like you used to before you met Jesus. Amen. Insecure, afraid, a broken heart. You had a void. Amen. You didn't have any peace. But now we have godly self-esteem. We have a new identity now, don't we? Amen. Hallelujah, that God has given you a new identity. Amen. God has given you a new name. God has given you God has given you a new mentality, a new attitude. Amen. God has given you a new identity. Amen. He calls you the new creation. Amen. You're the new creation. Let's look at 2 Kings chapter 6, verse 17. We know that God is with us. Amen. Let's look at this is a story of Elisha. And Elisha was with a servant, and they were being surrounded by various different armies. And Elisha was trying to encourage his servant. And so Elisha told him, you know, don't be afraid, don't worry. But the servant was scared. And so Elisha prayed and said, "Oh Lord, I pray, open his eyes that he may see." And the Lord opened the servant's eyes, and he saw, and behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. Amen. That's powerful, isn't it? Because it's the same with us. Amen. God is with us. Amen. God is with us. We don't have any reason to be afraid. We don't have any reason to fear. We don't have any reason to be afraid of the poor devil. We don't have any reason to be always focused on and worried about what this demon is saying or what that demon is doing, because God is with us. Hallelujah. Amen. God is with you. And we need to have boldness and confidence in God's word. Amen. If God was with Elisha in the Old Testament, how much more is he with us now in the New Testament with Jesus Christ dead and resurrected from the grave? Amen. We have a great, our testament, our covenant is greater than what they had in the Old Testament. Is that true?
Yeah.
Let's talk about Gideon. So if you've heard of the story of Gideon, this is a man who was in the Old Testament. It's out of the book of Judges. And what was going on with Gideon is that he was threshing wheat in a wine press. He was focused on his problems. Amen. This man Gideon was blaming God for all of his problems. And in his life, he was actually very insignificant at the time. He was unfulfilled at the time. His life was meaningless. But God chose him. And God called him, and God spoke identity over him. Amen. Let's start with Judges chapter 6. The Bible says in Judges chapter 6, "Then the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord." Can I tell you that all of our problems come from all the sins that we committed? Amen. God did not do this. God did not bring these problems on you to teach you a lesson or to hurt you. We opened that door, didn't we? We opened the door to the enemy, and that's why all the sins and the problems and the diseases and all the distractions have come against us. But so the Bible here says, "The children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord. So the Lord delivered them into the hand of Midian for 7 years, and the hand of Midian prevailed against Israel. Because of the Midianites, the children of Israel made for themselves the dens, the caves, and the strongholds which are in the mountains." So once again, the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord. Amen. So that's why Midian prevailed over them. And in I love Judges 6:12, because here you have Gideon in the wine press. He's complaining. He's not even really focused on the kingdom of God. Amen. He's just doing what he needs to do to get by. He's being negative. He's discouraged. He has a bad attitude. But this is what God says to him. Even in all of his mess, even with everything that he was going through, God says, God sent an angel, and the angel of the Lord appeared unto him and said unto him, "The Lord is with thee, thou mighty man of valor." Amen. Hallelujah. That the Lord is with us. Amen. Jesus Christ is with us. The Holy Ghost is with us. Amen. And that is the reason why we can become mighty men and women of God. Amen. You're a mighty woman of God because the Lord is with you. Amen. Amen. You're a mighty warrior now because the Lord is with you. You can do all things through Jesus Christ now because the Lord is with you. Amen. You're going to overcome that sin of the past because the Lord is with you. You're going to overcome that bad habit because the Lord is with you. Amen. You're going to be healed from that disease because the Lord is with you. You're going to live an exciting, adventurous life, knowing God and serving God. Amen. Because He's with you. Amen. This is an exciting, supernatural life, a relationship with God and Jesus Christ. Amen. I'm excited about my future because God is with me. Amen. I'm excited about my marriage because God is with me. I'm excited about my children growing up to be born again Christians because God is with them. Amen. We ought to be excited and we ought to know that the Lord is with us just the way He was with Gideon. Amen. And because He is with us, you are a mighty woman of God. You are a mighty man of God. Amen. That changes everything because the Lord is with us. Let's look at verse 13. So here Gideon is still walking in the flesh. He's still being negative. He doesn't believe what the Lord has just said. He says, "Oh my Lord, if the Lord is with us, why then has all this happened to us? And where are all the miracles which our fathers told us about, saying, 'Did not the Lord bring us up out of Egypt?' But now the Lord has abandoned us and given us into the hand of Midian." Let's look at verse 14. "And the Lord looked upon him and said, 'Go in this thy might, and thou shalt save Israel from the hand of the Midianites. Have not I sent thee?'" I love that because God is with us and God is going to send us. And let me ask you guys tonight, has the Lord looked upon you like He did Gideon? Amen. Yes, He has. Amen. Has God not sent you? Yes, He has, hasn't He? Hallelujah. God has sent you. God has looked upon you and God has sent you. Amen. To be a deliverer and an instrument of God's healing power. Amen. God has looked on you and is sending you to be an instrument of His love. Amen. When Jesus Christ looks on us, His love goes to work in our lives. Amen. Let me say that again. When Jesus Christ looks on us, His love is at work in your life. And love is a verb. Love is an action word. Amen. Love is Jesus Christ in action. Let's look at Mark 10:21. Here's the story of the young rich ruler. And he was asking Jesus how he can obtain eternal life. And Jesus told him, you know, Jesus used the law, and Jesus talked about the Ten Commandments. And then the young rich ruler said, "These I have kept. And then Jesus, the Bible says in Mark 10:21, do we have that up there? Mark 10:21, the Bible says, Jesus looked at him and loved him. "One thing you lack," He said, "go sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me." Amen. So we don't have that scripture up?
No, the next one is John.
Okay, my bad. So in Mark 10:21, the Bible says that Jesus looked at him and He loved him. Amen. And that's what God does with us. He looks at us and He loves us. Amen. When He looks on you, He can't help but to love you because God is love. So He's looking on you and He's loving on you. Amen. With an unconditional, supernatural, divine love. And He's looking at you and He's loving on you and He's going to tell you what needs to go. Just like He did with the young rich ruler here in Mark 10:21. The Bible again says Jesus looked at him and loved him and told him what he needed to do. Because this man's problem was that he thought that he was self-righteous. He thought that he could get into heaven just by obeying the Ten Commandments. And then Jesus hit him with what his real problem was idolatry. Amen. His real problem was the love of money. And Jesus says, "Go sell everything that you have and give it to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come follow me." So Jesus is going to look on us. He's going to love us. He's going to tell us what needs to go. Amen. It's going to hurt, isn't it? It's okay, though. He's going to tell us what needs to go. And then His priority is going to be in your life. Are you following Him? Because he told him, "Then come follow me." Amen. That is Jesus Christ's priority for us is to make sure that we're following Him. Amen. Are you following Jesus? Amen. Hallelujah. We're following Jesus. That's our life. That is our lifestyle. That is what our priority is, to follow Jesus Christ. Amen. God's love is the foundation for miracles. God's love is a soul healing and a hurt healing, pain destroying, life changing, shame defeating love of God. Amen. And Jesus and God's love is proof that Jesus is alive. Amen. God's love is proof that Jesus Christ rose from the grave. Let's look at 1 John chapter 4, verse 17 through 19. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casteth out fear, because fear hath torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. We love him because he first loved us. That's a powerful scripture. I love that scripture because we can have boldness now. Amen. We can have boldness now because of the love of God. And so it also says, because as he is, so are we in this world. What does that mean? That means that as Jesus was, so are we now in this world. Did you read that? Did you see that? Let me read that again because it's really powerful. Because as he is, so are we in this world. As who is? Jesus. Jesus, amen. As Jesus is, so are we in this world. That means that you're the light of the world now. That means that you're a follower of Jesus Christ. That means that you can perform miracles in your life. That means that you can cast out devils. That means that you can heal the sick. Amen. That means that you're going to line up with God's word and be a doer of God's word. That means that you're going to only believe God's word. Amen. That means that you're going to confess God's word in a powerful way. It goes on to say, there is no fear in love, but perfect love casteth out fear. Can I tell you that the only way you're going to overcome fear is by God's love? Amen. The only way you're going to overcome any fear or being afraid of the future or not walking by faith is by God's love. Amen. Because fear hath torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love. We love him because he first loved us. God is with us, and God and his love is at work in our lives. Amen. He is in the process right now of working everything out for you. Do you believe it? God is in the process of working everything out for you right now. Amen. If you can get that revelation that the living God is with you and that he will never leave you, that he will never forsake you, you will be passionate about the living God. Amen. You will be passionate about the kingdom of God. If you can get the revelation that God is with you, that he's never going to leave you, and that his love in your life is going to change everything forevermore, you will have Holy Ghost passion. Amen. And passion is good, isn't it? Yes. Hallelujah. Passion is good. I love passion. Say, I love passion. I love passion for the kingdom of God. Amen. I believe that Jesus Christ was a passionate servant of God. Amen. I believe that Jesus Christ was a passionate savior and healer and deliverer. Amen. And he still is. Amen. He looks on us. Remember that. He looks on you every day. Amen. He's looking on you tonight, and he loves on you, and he's going to tell you what needs to go. Amen. It might hurt, but in the end, it's for our best. It's for the best. Amen. Let's look at Hebrews chapter 13, verses 5 and 6. The Bible says, let your conduct be without covetousness. Be content with such things as you have, for he himself has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. So we may boldly say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What can man do to you? That's powerful. Hallelujah. Be content. We need to be content with the things that we have. Amen. We need to be content with the things that we have. And be content with such things as you have. For he has said, I will never leave you nor forsake you. Amen. What a wonderful promise. So that we may bold. Now, because God is never going to leave us or forsake us, we can boldly say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What can man do to me? Say it tonight. Say, the Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What can man do to me? That was too quiet. The Lord is my helper. I will not fear. What can man do to me? Because he is with us. Amen. Because he will never forsake us. We can boldly say that. Amen. Just like the I believe that was Paul that wrote that. Joshua chapter 1 verse 9, the Bible says, have I not commanded you, be strong and of good courage. Be not afraid nor be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Because he is with us, we don't ever have to be afraid, amen. Because God is with us, we can have courage and we don't have to ever be afraid nor be dismayed because he's with us. Say, God is with me.
God is with me.
Because he's with us, we never have to be afraid. We never have to be dismayed. We can know that we know that we know that God is with us, that God is for us, that God is in control, that God has a wonderful plan for our lives, that God is working everything out for our good, that God is at work behind every situation, that whatever the devil meant for harm, God's going to work it out for my and yours good. Amen. And that whatever the problem is, whatever the financial burden may be, whatever the symptom may be, whatever the lie may be, God is at work for you. Amen. Hallelujah. He's at work for you. Amen. And he is with you and he's looking on you and he is loving you. And he's going to bless us tonight. Amen. If you do not have a revelation of God's love, you need to stop everything that you're doing and make that a priority in your life. Amen. Can I say that again? If you do not have a revelation of God's love, you need to stop whatever you're doing and whatever you're trying to do. Amen. And focus on getting a revelation of the love of God. Because the revelation of the love of God is that you are loved by Almighty God and he died for you on the cross. Amen. And he sent his only begotten son that whosoever should believe in him will not perish but have everlasting life. Amen. And God's love is the greatest foundation for your life, for your ministry. God's love is the only foundation for Christianity. Amen. For true, sincere, genuine Christianity is the foundation, is God's love. And if you do not have a revelation of God's love, then I can tell you tonight that you're in trouble. Amen. And the devil will take advantage of that because we need a revelation of God's love. Amen. God is love. Amen. And Jesus Christ is I call him King Love. Amen. He loves us unconditionally, and he wants us to know how much he loves us. He wants us to have a revelation of his love. Amen. We need to stop everything else and cry out to God for a practical and a supernatural encounter and a revelation of the love of God. And when that happens, your life will never be the same. Amen. When you cry out and you seek God and you call unto God, he's going to answer you by his love. Amen. When you make a determination and you say, God, I do not know you as a God of love. Some of you might even be afraid of God, or you think God is angry or mad. But I'm here to tell you tonight that God is not mad at you. God is not angry with anybody. But God is radically, supernaturally, madly in love with you. Amen. Amen. And so we need to cry out to God and we need to seek a revelation of his love. And you just focus on that. With all your heart and your soul and everything that is in you. Amen. And you cry out to God in the morning before you go to bed. Whatever available time that you have, you get in your prayer closet and you cry out to God. Amen. And you just cry out sincerely and say, Father, I need a revelation of your love. Amen. Father, I do not want to go forward without an encounter with your love, God. I do not want to move forward in life until I get a revelation of how much you love me, God. Father, reveal to me how much I am loved. Father, pour out your love in a mighty way. You can just say, Father, I need an encounter with King Love. Father, I pour out your spirit and pour out your love according to Romans chapter 5, verse 5, and hope make it not ashamed, because the love of God has been shed abroad our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which was given unto us. Amen. You read that scripture, you memorize it, and you cry out to God. And you say, God, I need an encounter with the Holy Ghost and his love. And you mean it with all your heart. And what's going to happen? He'll come. He's going to pour out his love. It's going to be a powerful encounter, and it's going to be great. Your life is never going to be the same. Amen. So the key there is crying out to God. Amen. Humbling yourself. You might fast. You might do whatever you feel necessary, but you're going to cry out to God and you're going to get a revelation of God's love. Let's look at Jeremiah chapter 33, verse 3. I love this scripture because it just shows it just shows how practical God is. Amen. Jeremiah 33:3, the Bible says, call unto me. That Hebrew word for call there is the word kara. That means to call. To call out to God. Amen. To cry out to God. Have you cried out to God lately? Are you crying out to God on a daily basis? Amen. Are you a lazy Christian, or do you cry out to God on a daily basis? Do you spend 4 hours on Facebook and 3 hours on Netflix and expect God to answer you and expect the kingdom of God to manifest in your life when you pray for 5 minutes and you go to a church for 1 hour a week? Amen? Or are you crying out to God? I want to just be sincere tonight. I want to be honest with you. You need to cry out to God to get an answer. Amen? You cry out to God in a genuine, passionate way. Amen? And you cry out to God in whose name? Jesus Christ. Amen? You cry out to God in the name of Jesus, and God is going to answer you. That word there, once again, it means to call, to cry, to utter a loud sound. Amen? I get worried about those folks that say you don't need to get loud. I worry about them people that say, hey, you don't have to get loud. You don't have to get loud, or you don't have to cry out. You know, I get worried about those people. And then I also get worried about those that say, you don't have to do spiritual warfare, brother. You don't have to do anything, brother. God has already done everything for you. You can just spend 10 hours. You can spend 5 hours on Facebook and 3 hours on Netflix and the rest of the time being entertained. But God's going to do everything that you ask him to do because you spent 5 minutes with him. That worries me. Amen. Because the Bible but Jesus said, when you fast, anoint your head. And that means that you're supposed to fast. Amen. Jesus said, when you pray. So we're supposed to be fasting. We're supposed to be praying. And we're supposed to be crying out to God. Amen. We're supposed to be doing spiritual warfare. Amen? Is that true? We're supposed to be doing spiritual warfare, and we're supposed to be doing our part. Amen? You're supposed to be drawing near to God. The Bible says in James chapter 4, verse 7 and 8, submit yourselves therefore to God. You're supposed to be submitted to God. You're supposed to be submitted to the Word of God. You're supposed to be submitted to the kingdom of God. You're supposed to be submitted to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. You're supposed to be submitted to the Lordship of God's love. Amen. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil. That means that you got to resist the devil. Amen. Who's going to resist the devil for you?
Jesus.
You and Jesus inside of you. Amen. That's right. She's right. Jesus is going to help you resist the devil. That word means stand up against the devil. Okay? So you're supposed to submit yourselves therefore to God. Stand up against the devil and he will flee from you. Draw nigh to God and he will draw nigh to you. We're supposed to be drawing near to God. Amen? So my point was, initially, I don't know, I got off. But my point was that I get worried about those people that say you don't have to get loud. Because I believe that if Jesus needed to cry out, and when Jesus rose Lazarus from the grave, the Bible says that Jesus cried out. Amen? So if Jesus cried out, then we can do the same thing. Amen? So that word call there means to call, to cry, to utter a loud sound, to call unto, to cry for help, to call with the name of God, to read aloud. It also means to read aloud. Amen. I love that because we ought to be reading God's word aloud. Amen. It means to read to oneself. So the scripture says, call unto me and I will answer you and show you great and mighty things. I love that. Amen. When you cry out to God, he's going to answer you and he's going to show you great and mighty things. Amen. Those mighty things in that Hebrew word batsar means to gather restrained revelation. Secrets, mysteries, inaccessible things which thou knowest not. Amen. So when you cry out to God, God is going to reveal to you a revelation. When you cry out to God, God is going to show you a revelation of Jesus Christ. When you cry out to God, God is going to reveal Jesus to you. Amen. When you cry out to God, God is going to show you more of Jesus. God is going to give you more of Jesus. God is going to reveal more of Jesus. Amen. Who needs more? We all need more of Jesus Christ. Say it tonight. Say, I need more of Jesus. And so you're going to get a revelation when you cry out to God. Amen. When you cry out to God, when you call unto God in the name of Jesus, God is going to answer you and show you great and mighty things. Amen. Which we did not know. When I cried out to God, I was a heroin addict. I was in trouble. I was bound by the enemy. And I got into God's word, but I cried out to God. Amen. And I cried out to God, and I had a powerful encounter with God. And God revealed the face of Jesus Christ to me one night. Amen. And so that was that scripture. God, I was crying out to God, and God answered me, and he showed me the face of his son, Jesus. Amen. We need a powerful revelation of who Jesus Christ is. Amen. You need a powerful revelation and an encounter with how much God loves you. We need this revelation from God. Amen. Because it's going to build your faith. It's going to encourage you. It's going to give you boldness. God's going to help us with a revelation. Amen. Is that true? Our mind and our soul needs to be on Christ. Amen. King David said in Psalm 63:8, "My soul followeth hard after thee." Amen. I love that. "My soul followeth hard after thee. Thy right hand upholdeth me." In Hebrews chapter 12, verses 2 and 3, the Bible says, "Looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before us endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners against him, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds." When I consider Christ, my mind is going to be on point. Amen. When we consider Jesus Christ, your mind is, you're going to have the mind of Christ. Amen. So number one, we discussed God's love and that God is with us. Amen. Number two, believing is now. Believing is the verb form of faith. It is acting on the word of God. Amen. Believing is acting before God acts. It is having faith. It is having faith that God has already acted. Believing is an utter abandonment to the Father and to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. Amen. But believing is an absolute commitment of your entire being to the will of the Father. Believing God and his word will change our lives. Amen. John chapter 6, verse 47, the Bible says, "Verily I say unto you, he that believeth in me hath everlasting life." Amen. So when a believer is a possessor of the promises of God. When you believe God's word, you're going to possess the promises of God. Believing the word of God is an utter denial of the world mindset that rules those around us. Amen. Believing is the exchange of all that we have been for all that Jesus is. Believing is strength for every emergency. Victory for every battle. Amen. And now we lay hands on the sick, and it is his hands that is laid upon them. Amen. When we pray in the name of Jesus, it is Christ who is acting. Mark chapter 16, verse 17 and 18, the Bible says, "These signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils, speak with new tongues, take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover." Amen. So number two is believing. Believing is now. Believing is tonight. Amen. And God's going to do a great work tonight. Number three, we receive miracles by faith. Say, by faith. We're going to receive miracles tonight by faith. You cannot believe in Jesus until you confess his lordship. Amen. The moment you confess his lordship, he begins to act. Amen. In Romans chapter 10, verse 9, the Bible says, "If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved." So what we do is we believe and we confess with our mouth. Amen. We believe that the word of God is true, and we speak it with our mouth. Amen. So if you confess Jesus is Lord, you're going to be saved, and you believe it, you're going to be saved. What if you confess that Jesus is your healer and you believe it? You're going to be healed. Amen. What if you confess that Jesus Christ is deliverer and you believe it? You'll be delivered. Amen. So you put your mouth into operation and you confess it and you believe it in your heart that God hath raised him from the dead. Amen. And you're going to obtain a miracle. Amen. The word believe is a verb. The word faith is a noun. So believing, therefore, is the verb of faith. It is to act. You can't believe without acting. Amen. You cannot believe God's word without acting on his word. Amen. We're not going to believe God's word and then just lay on the couch all day and believe that you're sick. Amen. So you're going to believe God's word, and you're going to confess Jesus Christ is healer, and you're going to get off, you're going to get up, and you're going to go about your day because you believe and you know that Jesus Christ is your healer. Amen. Believing is possessing the victory in action. You're a believer. Amen. You are a believer in Jesus Christ, and you're going to obtain a miracle tonight. 1 John chapter 5, verses 4 through 5, the Bible says, whoever is born of God overcometh the world. And this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. Who is he that overcometh the world but he that believeth that Jesus Christ is a son of God? Do you believe that Jesus Christ is a son of God? Yes. Amen. So that means that you're overcoming the world. Amen. Say, I am overcoming the world. I am overcoming the world. I have overcome the world. And that is happening because you believe that Jesus is the Son of God. Amen. So you might be going through something. You might be going through a trial. There might be a crisis in your life right now. All hell might be coming against you. But that does not matter because God's word says if you believe that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, then you are an overcomer. Amen. Amen. You're overcoming the situation that you're in right now. You're overcoming the problems. You're overcoming the bad habits. You're overcoming the enemy. Amen. God cannot lie. Hallelujah. You cannot trust God with all your heart as long as you're leaning on somebody else. The first step in faith is reaching the place where you abandon all. Amen. We need to abandon all for the word of God. It's not that easy, is it? But we can do it. We can abandon everything for God's word and what God says. You can abandon the lies of the devil. You can abandon what the world has to say. You can abandon your past for the word of God. Amen? We have trusted in everything else, haven't we? We have trusted in the doctor, didn't we? We trusted what everybody else told us. You trusted what your wife or your husband may have told you. You trusted yourself, but now trust in the Lord only. And stop leaning on your own understanding. Amen. God, like she just said right now, God cannot lie. Entrust yourself utterly to the living God. Amen. We can do that. You can do that. Entrust yourself utterly to the living God. Proverbs chapter 3, verse 5. Trust in the Lord. Amen. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart and lean not on thine own understanding. That's good, isn't it? Say, that's good. God's word cannot be broken. Amen. The man who trusts in the Lord is trusting the safest bank in the universe. Amen. When the believer begins to walk by faith, he or she walks in the same realm in which Jesus walked. That was good. When the believer begins to walk by faith, he or she walks in the same realm that Jesus walked. Faith doesn't care a thing about what the natural eye can see, what the natural ear can hear, or what the physical body can feel. Faith sees only the omnipotence, power, ability, and the grace of God. Amen? Faith sees only the power, ability, and the grace of God. Amen? Do you see the grace of God in your life? Can you see God's word activated in your life? Can you see the promise of God in your life? Can you see the promise of God that God's going to supply all your need? Can you see the promise manifested in your life that by his stripes ye were healed? Yes. Can you see the promise of God that you have power over the devil? Yes. According to Luke chapter 10, verse 19. Can you see the promise of God in your life individually that you're going to cast out devils? Yes. Out of yourself and out of friends and family? Amen? Yes. Can you see the promise of God being manifested in your life? Because if you cannot see it, then you need to come to a place where you can see God's promise. Where you can see yourself receiving, obtaining the miracles of God. Amen. I was so tormented by poverty that I could not see myself opening or generating new business. It was a lie from the devil. Amen. God healed me from that. Amen. Because now I walk by faith. Now I can believe God that he's going to provide all my needs. Now I don't have to worry about living from paycheck to paycheck anymore. Now I can know that I know that I know with in my soul that God is at work in my finances. That God is at work in my marriage. That God is at work with my children. That God is at work in my body. That God is at work in the ministry he's called me to. Amen. We have to see it. We have to see it first. Amen. That is faith. Seeing it. Jesus meant it when he said in Matthew 17:20, nothing shall be impossible unto you. So we need to renounce the mindset of the world. Amen. The mind of Christ is the faith mind. The mind of the world is unbelief and pride and rebellion. Amen. Is that true? Faith counts the work as done. Say it's done. Faith counts the work as done, even when Satan seems to be in control. Faith sees Satan defeated, even when he is destroying lives. Faith moves and acts with the quietness and the peace and the confidence of God's word. Faith knows that God cannot lie. If God said it, then hallelujah, I'm going to receive it. Amen. If God said that in Matthew chapter 19, verses 5 and 6, therefore the Bible says there, talking about marriage, that you're going to cleave to your wife, that therefore God has joined together, let no man separate. Amen? So that means that I'm not going to get a divorce. Hallelujah. Amen? If the Bible says that you're going to lay hands on the sick and they're going to recover, that means that when someone prays for you, you will recover. Amen? Faith says, rise and stand upon thy feet. Amen. Faith never argues about it. Faith stands quiet and wrapped in the integrity of God's word. Is God's word good? It's good. Amen. Hallelujah. Isaiah chapter 55, verse 11. Jehovah said about his word, so shall my word be that goeth forth out of my mouth. It shall not return unto me void, but it shall accomplish that which I please, and it shall prosper in the thing whereto I sent it. Amen. So God's word is going to prosper in your life. Amen. Has God sent his word to you? The Bible says in Psalm 107:20, he sent his word and healed them and delivered them from their destructions. Amen. God has sent his word, and his word is going to prosper in your life. Jesus is the word. She's preaching. You can preach for me next month. Hallelujah. Jesus is the word. That's powerful. And the word was made flesh and dwelt among us. We beheld his glory. Amen. The glory of the Father. So, number four, we need to fully surrender all to Jesus Christ. Amen. The surrendered life is the only life worth living. Amen. I'm here to tell you tonight. Can I tell you that you cannot have it your way? Amen. You cannot do the things that you want to do. It has to be Christ. It has to be Christ's way. It has to be your life is fully surrendered to Jesus. Amen. You have to give Jesus all of your life. You have to surrender everything to Jesus. Amen. It's going to be beautiful. Don't be afraid. It's not easy, but we can do it, and it's going to be a beautiful thing when you give God, when you surrender everything to Jesus Christ, amen? When you surrender everything to Jesus, all the worry. The Bible says casting all your care upon him, for he careth for you. Give him all your cares and all your worries, amen? Give him all the issues that are coming against you. Give him all the problems that are coming against you. Give him every distraction. Amen. Give him every lie that you've believed in the past. The surrendered life is the only life worth living. Amen. The first step to having this type of life is to recognize the lordship of Jesus Christ. Amen. You stop your own efforts to make yourself better. You simply lift up your heart to Jesus and you say, Jesus, from this hour, I give you the lordship and dominion over my life. Amen. From now on until I finish the course, you are Lord and you are Master, Jesus Christ. Say it tonight. Say, Jesus. You are Lord and Master. I give you my life. Amen. Give him a hand clap. Powerful things are going to happen in your life when you fully surrender to Jesus Christ. Amen. When you give him everything. When you give him your all. Amen. Colossians chapter 2, verses 9 and 10, the Bible says, for in him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and you are complete in him, which is the head of all principality and power. Who is complete in him? Us. Amen. So we are complete in Jesus Christ, which is the head of all principality and power. Philippians chapter 4, verse 13, I can do all things through the Christ, which strengtheneth me. Amen. Romans chapter 8, verse 37. Yet in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. Amen. So you're going to conquer because he loves you. Amen. Say, he loves me. So number five is we need to see ourselves in the Word of God. See yourself in the Word to obtain a miracle. Amen. Most of us are what we believe, and most of us believe in what we hear rather than what we read in the Word of God. Some of us believe parts of the Word. Some of us never have made a serious effort to find out what the Word says. Amen. Some of us do not take the Word of God seriously. And we are familiar to thinking of ourselves as the world sees us, as inferior. Amen. But I'm here to tell you that you are what God says that you are. Amen. You are what God's Word says that you are. You are not, you're not a failure. Amen. You are not a loser. You are not bound by the enemy. Things are changing for you, and you are what God says that you are. Let's look at the Word to see who we really are in Christ. Amen. Let's look at Colossians chapter 1, verse 13. Who hath delivered us from the power of darkness. Praise God that you have been delivered from the power of darkness. Or if you haven't been, you will be delivered from the power of darkness. I have been delivered from the power of darkness. Amen. I don't smoke heroin anymore. Hallelujah. I don't have to cheat on my wife anymore. I can love my wife. I can bless my wife. I can be the husband that my wife deserves. I can be the husband and the dad to my children that God has called me to be. Amen. I can be successful in every area of my life because I was delivered from the power of darkness and I was translated into the kingdom of Jesus Christ. Amen. God is doing a glorious work on your behalf in your life. And you, if you haven't been already, you are being delivered from the power of darkness and you are being translated into the kingdom of his dear son. Amen. Your life is going to radically change. Your life is going to be absolutely astonishing and amazing and adventurous and powerful. Amen. This is your identity. This is who you are. You have been delivered from the power of darkness and you have been translated into the kingdom of God. Amen. The Word says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Behold, all things are become new. That is you. Amen. That is you. God is talking about you here. Amen. God is talking about me. He's talking about you. Amen. You're a new creation. If you are a born again Christian, amen, you are a new creation. And behold, all things are become new. Old things are passing away. Old things have passed away. Amen. The shame from the past has passed away. The fear of the past is passing away. Amen. The disease has passed away. The poverty has passed away. The unbelief has passed away. The hatred has passed away. The rejection has passed away. The demonic influence is passing away. Amen. And God is making you or creating you the new creation. Amen. God calls you the new creation. Is that exciting to you? I love the sound of that. Say, I am the new creation.
I am the new creation.
The new things are the life of God, the righteousness of God, the ability of God in your life to overcome, and the love of God. Amen. You are mighty sons and daughters of God now. 1 John chapter 3, verse 2, the Bible says, beloved, now are we the sons of God, and it doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. Romans chapter 8, verse 16 and 17. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, heirs of God and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. Amen. You're a joint heir with Jesus Christ. Do you believe that? You stand in Christ as an absolute victor. Amen. You stand in Christ as an absolute victor. God is doing it. Philippians chapter 4, verse 19. My God shall supply all your needs according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus. You are no longer slaves to need, poverty, and lack. Amen. You are sons and daughters of God. the God of plenty, the God of resources, and the God of grace. Amen. Ephesians chapter 1 verse 3. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Jesus Christ. Amen. That is us. That is you. He's doing that in your life. Amen. Your life is going to be changed. You're going to smile more often. Amen. Smile for me tonight. Come on. Hallelujah. Give Jesus a hand clap for what he's doing in your life. Because I know before I met Jesus Christ, I never smiled. Amen. I was miserable. My life, I was tormented. My life was horrible. Amen. But now today I can smile because I know Jesus Christ. Amen. I know who I know my identity in Jesus Christ. I know that God's at work in my life. Amen. That doesn't mean that life's going to be easy now, but it's going to mean that God is with me and I have the promises of God and I'm going to obtain miracles in my life and I'm going to see God at work. I'm going to obey God.
Yes.
But it's not going to be easy. Amen. But it's going to be worth it. You are blessed and you know that you are blessed. You are healed by the stripes of the Lord Jesus Christ, and you know that you are healed or that you are being healed. What he declares you are, amen? What God declares that you are, you are. When he declares that you are justified, you are justified. What does that fancy word mean? Just as if you never sinned, amen? Justified means just as if I never sinned. When he declares you righteous, you are the righteousness of God. When he declares that you are strong, you are strong. When he says through the Apostle Paul, there is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. That is you. That is us. Amen. That is you. Your heart responds to his word and you praise him for it. Amen. Hallelujah. Your heart responds to the word of God and you give Jesus praise for his word and for what he has said about you in his word. And come on, give him praise tonight. Thank you, Jesus. Lord, I praise you tonight that I am who you say that I am. I thank you, Jesus, that I have been delivered from the power of darkness and translated into the kingdom of your dear Son. Father, I thank you that you do supply all my needs according to your riches and glory. Father, I thank you that by your stripes I was healed. Your heart responds to his word and you praise him for it. Amen. You repeat it over and over in your heart that you are a child of God. That you are a partaker of a divine nature. That you have passed from death unto life. And that you say that you were delivered from the power of darkness and translated in the kingdom of his dear Son. You say that sin shall not have dominion over you. You say I was made free from sin. You say that by his stripes I am healed. And when you say that, when you change your confession, when you say these things, Jesus Christ, who is the high priest of your confession, is going to make this good in your life. Amen. Because Hebrews chapter 3 verse 1, the Bible says, therefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our confession, Christ Jesus. So in other words, when you confess the word of God, the high priest of our confession is going to make it good in your life. Amen. Faith is a result of hearing the word of God and then acting on it. God said that you are his son and daughter. He says that you are redeemed. He says that you're healed. Now you look up and say, Father, I thank you that what you say is true. Amen. Can we do that? Can we look up? Can we pray to the Father and cry out to the Father and say, Father, I thank you that what you say is true. It doesn't make a difference how you feel. It doesn't make a difference of what things might appear like. Amen. But you're a man and a woman of action according to the word of God. Romans 10:17, faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word of God. James chapter 2 verse 17, even so faith, if it hath not works, is dead. So number 5 was, we receive miracles by faith. Amen. Number 6, the power of praise will manifest miracles. Worship basis, amen. Do you give God praise on a daily basis? If you'll focus your efforts on praising the Lord, God will work mightily in your life, amen. I want to say that again. If you'll focus on just praising God, God's going to bless you. God's going to work a wonderful miracle in your life. Amen. We have every reason to praise Jesus, don't we? Jesus came and he died on the cross for our sins. Amen. And by his shed blood, we have been redeemed from the hand of the enemy. We ought to give Jesus praise for that on a daily basis. Amen. We can praise God for numerous things. Praise ought to be a part of your daily, a daily thing that we do. Amen. I'm convinced that if you can accomplish anything God has called you to do, if you'll just praise the Lord. When you daily express your wholehearted praise to the Lord Jesus, God's going to work in your life, since the Lord inhabits our praises. The manifestations of his power to heal and deliver are the byproducts. So when you praise God, his miracles and his power to heal and deliver is going to be the byproduct of your praise. Psalm 22:3, the Bible says, "But thou art holy, O thou that inhabitest the praises of Israel." Amen. Can you praise Jesus on a daily basis? Will you praise God every day? Number 7, righteousness restored. Amen. The Supreme Court of the universe declared that what God did through Jesus Christ was enough. Amen. What God did through Jesus Christ and the cross and the shed blood of Jesus Christ is enough. Amen. You don't have to add anything to it. You don't have to do anything to add to it. Amen. You don't have to take up an offering. You don't have to suffer a little. You don't have to do it. What God did through Jesus Christ at the cross is enough. Amen. His sufferings was satisfactory to meet each and every demand of justice. God laid our sins on Jesus, who was made to be sin and made to suffer on our behalf. Amen. When he met the demands of justice, death could no longer hold him. He was declared righteous. He was made alive. He became the head of the new creation. And now when you believe in Jesus Christ as your Savior, God is able to declare you righteous on the grounds of what Jesus did. Amen. 2 Corinthians 5:21, the Bible says, "For he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might become the righteousness of God in him." Amen. So we can be the righteousness of God in Jesus Christ and what he's done for us. Amen. Say it tonight. Say, "I am the righteousness of God."
I am the righteousness.
And just as surely as God made Jesus sin, he makes you righteous now. Amen. God himself becomes the righteousness of the man who has faith in Jesus. The moment you accept Jesus Christ as your Savior and confess him as Lord, God becomes your righteousness. And now you stand before him justified and righteous, as though you had never sinned. Amen. Say hallelujah. Number 8 is passion and persistence. Amen. Let's go to Mark chapter 10, verses 46 through 52. Mark chapter 10, verses 46 through 52. This is a story here of blind Bartimaeus. The Bible says, "And they came to Jericho, and as he was going forth from Jericho with his disciples, a great multitude, a son of Timaeus, Bartimaeus the blind, was sitting beside the way begging, and having heard that it was Jesus the Nazarene, he began to cry out and to say, 'Son of David, Jesus, deal kindly with me.'" So as they came to Jericho, as he went out to Jericho with his disciples and a great multitude, the blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the road begging. Amen. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." So what I like there in verse 47 is that he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth. Amen. Have you heard about how powerful Jesus Christ is? Yes, you have. You have heard all the stories about Jesus Christ. You have heard the word of God. Amen. You have heard everything that you need to hear about Jesus Christ. And now we come to him just like blind Bartimaeus did, and we cry out to Jesus. Amen. So it goes on to say this, son of David. I like this version better. So when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." Then many warned him to be quiet, but he cried out all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." I love that, because they're trying to tell him to be quiet. They're trying to shut him up, but he cries out the more and he says, "Jesus, have mercy on me." Amen. Verse 29. "So Jesus stood still and commanded him to be called. Then they called the blind man, saying to him, 'Be of good cheer. Rise, he is calling you.' Verse 50, and throwing aside his garment, he rose and came to Jesus. So Jesus answered him and said to him, what do you want me to do for you? I love that. Amen. You know, we have a lot of needs, don't we? We have a lot of needs. Amen. But when you come to a point that you want something, amen, did Jesus know that Bartimaeus was already blind? He already knew that he was blind, didn't he? But he still, Jesus took the time to ask him, what do you want me to do for you? Because when you want, I'm here to tell, can I tell you tonight that when you want something from the living God, your attitude is going to change, amen? When you want something from God, you're going to pursue God with all your heart. When you want something from the living God, you're going to surrender the old life. You're going to surrender the world. You're going to surrender the lies of the devil. You're going to surrender the bad habits. You're going to surrender the sin that easily besets us. You're going to surrender your past, and you're going to come to Jesus Christ, and you're going to pursue Jesus Christ, and you're going to cry out to Jesus Christ, and he's going to answer you. Amen. But it says that, I love verse 49. Let's read that again. Jesus stood still. How many of us know that Jesus Christ was busy at this time? Amen. He only had 3 years to do what he had to do. Amen. Jesus had a lot to do in 3 years, didn't he? He had to raise up disciples. He had to start the church. He had to save the world. He had to die and resurrect from the grave. He had limited time. He had a lot of things to do, didn't he? But here, blind Bartimaeus causes Jesus to stand still. And so Jesus commanded him to be called. So then they called the blind man, saying, "Be of good cheer. Rise, he is calling you." And verse 50 says, and throwing aside his garment, he rose and came to Jesus. You know, that garment represented his old identity. That garment represented his blindness. Amen. That garment represented his past. That garment represented who he was before Christ. But when he heard about Jesus, and when he saw Jesus of Nazareth coming, he knew that he was about to encounter God, so he set aside his garment. Amen? Amen. Hallelujah. You might have to set aside some things in your life. Amen. You might have to set aside that old person that you know that you shouldn't be dating anymore. You might have to set aside those lies of the enemy. You might have to set aside some fear. You might have to set aside the flesh, but you're going to have to set aside something, amen? So the Bible says he throwing aside his garment, he rose and came to Jesus, and Jesus answered him and said to him, what do you want me to do? I love that, amen, because when you want something, it's different than when you need something, amen? You might have to cry out continuously and cry out all the more. Amen. So they tried to shut him up, but he cried out all the more. Amen. Verse 50. Let's look at verse 51. So Jesus answered him and said to him, what do you want me to do for you? The blind man said to him, Rabbi, that I might receive my sight. So Jesus said to him, go your way. Your faith has made you well. And immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus on the way. Amen. So here, this blind man recognized our Lord as the Son of David. Amen. How many of us know that back then, even the Jews didn't even know who Jesus was? Amen. And so blind Bartimaeus recognized Jesus as the Son of David. Here, a blind Jew had true spiritual sight, didn't he? Amen. And so that garment represented his identity as a blind beggar. Amen. That garment represented his old name, his old identity, amen? So Bartimaeus, that word is chaldee of origin, and that means son of Timaeus. Timaeus means unclean, amen? So that's what his old identity was. But now he had true spiritual sight of who Jesus was. He knew that he was the Son of David. So we learn three things here from Bartimaeus, amen? We know that he had a desperate need. Do you have a desperate need tonight? First, and second, he had a determination to have his want met. Amen. And third, he came to Christ in the confidence of who Jesus Christ was. Amen. There was no doubt in him that he was the promised Messiah, the promised Christ of the living God, the promised heir to the throne, the Son of David. Amen. So tonight we're going to come to Jesus Christ in the confidence of who Jesus is. Amen. We come to Christ in the confidence of who he is. He's master. He's the giver of life. Amen. He's Savior. We come to Jesus Christ in the revelation and in the confidence of knowing that Jesus Christ is healer. Amen. We know that Jesus Christ is deliverer, and he's the baptizer of the Holy Ghost, and he's the Lord, and he's King. Amen. So we're going to come to God just like blind Bartimaeus did, and we're going to obtain a miracle because we know that we know that we know that he is the Son of David, that he is the Son of God, that he is our healer, that he is your deliverer. Amen. We pursue salvation to preach the gospel of Christ. So the end result is to operate as a glorious kingdom of God on the earth. Amen. So the end result of obtaining a miracle and pursuing the kingdom of God is to manifest on the earth the kingdom of God. And we pursue salvation to preach the gospel of Jesus Christ. We pursue divine healing to heal the sick. We pursue the children's bread to cast out demons. Amen. We pursue the baptism of fire to be ministers of fire and preach and prophesy by fire. We pursue prosperity to show the church how to prosper and to give financially to the kingdom of God. We pursue sanity to love the mentally ill. Amen. We pursue the authority of Jesus Christ to represent Christ on the earth. Amen. We pursue God's love so that we can love. And we pursue God's power to break Satan's power. Amen. Praise God. So once again, we're talking about miracles tonight. And I believe that miracles are God's way of getting our attention. Amen. God is going to get your attention by performing a miracle in your life. Mark 9:23, the Bible says, Jesus said, if thou canst believe, all things are possible to him that believeth. John chapter 14, verse 12, the Bible says, he that believeth on me, the works I do shall he also do, and greater works shall he do because I go unto my Father. John 14, if you ask anything in my name, I will do it. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20, the Bible says, now unto him that is able to do exceedingly abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to the power that worketh in us. Matthew 18:19, if two of you will agree on earth concerning anything that they ask, it will be done for them by my Father which is in heaven. For where two or three are gathered together in my name, I am there in the midst of them. So as we act upon these scriptures tonight, we can expect the Holy Ghost to minister miracles and divine healing and deliverance and salvation tonight. Amen. Are you guys ready? I've been talking for about an hour already, and I believe it's just time to get into God, into the altar ministry. And God's going to have his way tonight. Amen? Amen. Praise God. Let's pray. Let's turn that music on, brother. I want to pray for you guys. Father, thank you for the beautiful church here tonight. Thank you for miracles in our lives. Thank you that you've ordained miracles tonight, Father. Thank you for what you're going to do tonight. I pray tonight, God, that we would have an encounter with the living God. I pray tonight that we would have an encounter with your love. Thank you for what you're going to do tonight, Father, in Jesus' mighty name. The Bible says in Mark chapter 16, verse 17 and 18, these signs shall follow them that believe. In my name shall they cast out devils, speak with new tongues, take up serpents. If they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. So that's what we're going to do tonight, amen. We're going to simply just lay hands on you and you're going to recover. We're going to pray for you and God's going to perform a miracle in your life. And God's going to bless you tonight. Amen. I want to just lead you in a prayer of repentance so that God would have his way tonight. Amen. Just repeat this prayer after me. Say, Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus, I confess all my sins. In the name of Jesus Christ, thank you for what you're going to do tonight. By the blood of Jesus, I was justified. By the blood of Jesus Christ, I was redeemed from the hand of the enemy. By the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, I was delivered from the power of darkness. Thank you, Father, for your blood that was shed at the cross. Tonight, let's forgive. I want us to tonight forgive those that need to be forgiven. Amen. If you have any odd or if you have any ill thoughts or feelings toward anybody, if anybody hurt you in any way, forgiveness is powerful. Amen. And Jesus said in Matthew 6:17, if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive men their trespasses, neither will your heavenly Father forgive you. So tonight, let's forgive those that have hurt us, those that have rejected us, those that abandoned us, those that physically abused us or sexually molested you. Forgive that person that hurt you. Do it now. You might say something like this: Father, in the name of Jesus, I forgive so and so for what they did to me. In Jesus' name, I forgive everybody that ever hurt me. Don't give the devil any reason or any legal right through unforgiveness. Amen. I forgive my dad for the rejection when I was young. I forgive my mother for the things that she said about me. I forgive those that hurt me. Anybody that ever harmed you in any way, assaulted you. Forgiveness is a beautiful thing, amen. Forgiveness is a supernatural, powerful door opener to the kingdom of God, amen. It's going to open that door for that long-awaited miracle and blessing when you forgive. Go ahead, do it now. You're doing great. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, I forgive my ex-husband. I forgive my ex-boyfriend for the things that he did to me. I forgive that person that took advantage of me 10 years ago. I forgive myself. Forgive yourself. Don't be so hard on yourself. Forgive yourself. Thank you, Jesus. I forgive myself in the name of Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Give Jesus a hand clap. Thank you, Lord. And the last thing I want to do quickly is just, we're going to just renounce the rotten devil. Amen. Because the devil thinks he's such a pathetic, poor devil, but he thinks that he has an actual right to continue to torment you or to continue to influence your life. But what we need to do is you need to rise up as the church of the living God in the authority that Jesus Christ has given you in his name and remind that poor devil that he was defeated at the cross of Jesus Christ. Amen? He is defeated, and so we just need to remind him, you poor devil, you cannot have influence in my life anymore. You rotten devil, you cannot torment me anymore. You rotten devil. You are defeated in the name of Jesus. I command you to take your filthy hands off my life. Amen. Amen. And so we're just going to remind him. We're going to renounce his lies. We're going to renounce the authority you may have given him. I'll be honest with you. When you commit sin, you're giving the enemy legal entry. Amen. So if it was some kind of witchcraft or some kind of demonic legal entry, if you played the Ouija board 10 years ago and that bondage was never broken, then tonight we're going to renounce it and we're going to break it. Amen. But tonight we're going to do what God has called us to do, and that is renounce the devil and break his power, and then God's going to do his part. Amen. So you're the church, and God, and the Bible says draw nigh to God and he's going to draw nigh to us. Amen. So we're going to draw near to God right now by renouncing the enemy, renouncing all the sin of the past, and breaking the devil's power, and shaming the devil, and reminding him that he is defeated, and that he no longer has permission to be in your life anymore. He has no legal entry anymore. He is being evicted in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Say it tonight. Say, in the name of Jesus Christ, you poor devil, I renounce you. I renounce all of your lies. In the name of Jesus Christ, I renounce any open door to darkness. In the name of Jesus Christ, I renounce the authority I may have given the devil from past sin. In the name of Jesus Christ, I renounce the authority I gave the enemy by believing his lies. In the name of Jesus, I renounce the ancestral sin. In the name of Jesus Christ, I renounce the witchcraft. I renounce the occult. I renounce darkness. In Jesus' name. I renounce the authority that was given to Satan by the sins that were committed against me. Hallelujah. Give Jesus a hand clap. Thank you, Lord, that those doors are being closed to the devil. Thank you, Lord, that that legal entry has been shut to the enemy. Thank you, Lord, that your church is, that there is freedom in this place. Thank you, Lord, for 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse 17. Now the Lord is a spirit, and where the spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Come on, keep doing some renunciation. Allow the Holy Ghost to remind you what needs to be renounced. Say, in Jesus' name, I renounce the ancestral sin of idolatry. In Jesus' name, I renounce the authority I gave Satan by not tithing. In Jesus' name, I renounce self-hatred because of what my father said about me. In Jesus' name, I renounce the rejection. In Jesus' name, I renounce expecting to be rejected. In Jesus' name, I renounce the authority I gave Satan by word curses. In Jesus' name, I renounce the authority given to the enemy through word curses that were spoken over me. In Jesus' name, I renounce every curse. Hallelujah. How many of us know that God is at work right now? Amen. God is right now. The enemy is exposed right now. Amen. And the enemy is losing authority, and the enemy is defeated. Amen. And he's under your feet. That's why Jesus said in Luke 10:19, behold, I give unto you power to tread on serpents and scorpions and on all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Amen. That scripture is coming to life right now in this place. Amen. That God is placing your enemies under your feet. Tonight we're going to trample and tread upon the enemy. Amen. That word there, tread upon, that word tread there means to advance by setting your foot upon. It means to trample and tread down underfoot. Amen. And we're simply going to break the devil's power. We have authority. You're the beautiful church of the living God. And God has given us power. Amen. God has given us dunamis power and authority. And most importantly, God has given us his name. And tonight we're going to put that name into operation. Amen. Let's break the devil's power right now. Amen. Put your hand on your stomach and just say, in the name of Jesus Christ. Listen to me, devil. I break your power right now. I have power over you, devil. You have been defeated at the cross of Jesus Christ. You are under the feet of the Christ. You are under the feet of the church. In Jesus' name. I break your power right now. In Jesus Christ's name. Demons coming against me. I break your power. In the name of Jesus Christ. Darkness, I break your power. On the authority of God's word. And on the authority of the name of Jesus. By the power of the Holy Ghost. I trample. And I tread upon serpents and scorpions and over all the lies of the devil. Do you believe it?
Yes.
Hallelujah. God is doing it right now. Hallelujah. God, right now, it's taking place right now. Say, in Jesus' name, devil, I break your power. Devil, you are being evicted from my life. You have no legal right anymore. In Jesus' name. Rejection, shame, and fear. I break your power now. In the name of Jesus. Disease, I break your power right now. In the name of Jesus. Witchcraft, I break your power right now. In the name of Jesus Christ. Anger and hatred, negative emotions. Discouragement, I break your power right now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for what you're doing, Jesus. Thank you for the shed blood of the cross. Thank you for your name, Jesus Christ. Thank you for the authority you've given me over the enemy. In the name of Jesus. Distractions. Fear. Disease, I break your power. Poverty, I break your power in Jesus' name. Go ahead, just speak to that mountain right now. Whatever is coming against you right now, individually, I want this to be personal for you right now. Whatever is coming against you right now, whatever that mountain is, we know that Jesus said in Mark 11:23, whoever says unto this mountain, be thou removed and be thou cast into the sea, and does not doubt it in his heart, but believes those things he says will come to pass, he will have whatever he says. Amen? So let's do that right now. Whatever that mountain is that's standing in front of you, whatever that mountain is, that demonic mountain, it has to go. Amen? Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Speak to that devil. Speak to the enemy. And speak to that mountain and say, move in Jesus' name. I command you to go in Jesus' name. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Have your way tonight, Father. Thank you for miracles in this place. Thank you for divine healing in this place. Thank you for divine miracles in this place. Whatever it is has to go. Amen. I want to invite the ministry team up here. Let's go ahead and just get into a time of warfare. We know the Bible said, we know that Paul said, he that warreth, entangles not himself with the affairs of this life, that he may please him who enlisted him as a soldier. Amen. So tonight we're going to war a good warfare. Amen. And God's going to bless his church tonight. I want to just invite you up here. If you need a miracle, if there's any pain, if you have any pain, if you need deliverance, whatever you may need, we're going to agree with you and we're going to pray for you and with you and see God bless you. Amen. Does anybody have any pain? You do? Come here, I want to pray for you first. Then. No, I'm sorry, her right behind you, and then you're next. So how are you? Okay, good. So what's going on? What kind of pain are you going through? Your coworker's voice tormenting you? Okay. So is there like pain, or is it just like demonic influence? Okay, so there's no pain, no body pain or anything like that? There is body pain. What is that?
Just my face.
Like a headache?
Like certain parts of my body.
Okay, well, what's the name of your coworker?
Andrea Martin.
Okay, the first thing I want you to do, and I'm sure that God has already asked you to do this, but just let's just forgive her, amen? Just forgive her, say in the name of Jesus.
In the name of Jesus.
I forgive Andrea for what she said.
I forgive Andrea what she said.
In Jesus' name, I bless Andrea.
In Jesus' name.
I release Andrea.
I release Andrea.
And I pray for Andrea now.
And I pray for Andrea.
Say,
now.
Father, I thank you for blessing Andrea.
Thank you, Father, for blessing Andrea.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
I renounce the authority.
The
enemy has had because of that relationship with Andrea. Say, I renounce the authority.
I renounce the authority.
The enemy has had.
The enemy has had.
Because of Andrea.
Because of Andrea.
Is there anybody else that you want to forgive? Okay, this disease, this infirmity, this influence has to leave you right now. Amen. On the authority of God's word, pray with me, church. On the authority of God's word, in the name of Jesus Christ, I command you, devil, to loose her right now. In Jesus Christ's name, I break that power. I break the stronghold now on the authority of God's word. In Jesus' name, devil, I command you to go right now. In Jesus' mighty name, come out of her right now. You cannot torment her and you cannot influence her anymore. I command that pressure, I command that pain, I command that shame, and I command that hurt to go right now in Jesus' mighty name. Just take a deep breath and go, come out of her in Jesus' name. Now, go in Jesus' name. Go in the name of Jesus. Have you been here before? So have you gone through any kind of deliverance before?
I have.
Okay. Just come pray with her. So what I want you to do is continue to just pray for some release and some more deliverance right now. Amen.
Okay. Pain, leave in the name of Jesus.
You want to? You need some prayer as well. Can we pray with you? Yeah. Or did you raise your hand? Okay.
I command you by the power of the Holy Spirit. Leave. Leave. Leave in the name of Jesus. Leave. Leave. Be broken off. Power of pain.
What's going on?
My legs, they hurt. They're real tight.
You just have pain in your legs?
Yeah, they're
broken. In the name of Jesus Christ, I command this pain to leave right now. On the authority of God's word, in Jesus' name, I say, pain, leave her right now. In Jesus' mighty name, I break every curse causing pain. In Jesus' name, I break every demonic yoke. In Jesus' mighty name, I break the power of the enemy. In Jesus' name, pain, leave right now. In the name of Jesus, be healed right now. In Jesus' name, I just walk and test it. Do something you couldn't do before. Okay, move it up and down like this. Just say, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. In the name of Jesus, be healed and be restored for the glory of God. In Jesus' name, I break every witchcraft curse causing disease. In Jesus' name, I break the bondage. In Jesus' name, I break the power of darkness. In Jesus' name, I break demon power now. In Jesus' mighty name. Listen to me, devil. Take your filthy hands off her knees right now and come out of her. In the name of Jesus, come out of her. In the name of Jesus, demons causing pain, come out of her now. Go. Out. Come out of her in Jesus' name. Move them up like this. Is there a difference? In Jesus' name, be restored and be healed. Walk around. Thank you, Lord. They're still in pain? Let's pray with her for some deliverance. We're going to continue to pray for you, okay? Just turn that music up just a little bit, brother. Anybody out? Okay, just pray for me now. I'm sorry. How are you?
There's times like in the day, like, you know,
thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, on the authority of God's word, we break every curse. I break bondage. I break the power of disease and pain in Jesus' name. I break generational curses right now in Jesus' name. You demons causing these problems, you demons causing pain, I break your power right now in the name of Jesus Christ. Listen to me, devil. I command you to take your filthy hands off her head, take your filthy hands off her body in Jesus' mighty name right now. I bind you, devil, and I break your power, and I command you to go right now. I want you to forgive yourself for any past sin. Say, in Jesus' name, I forgive myself. I repent from any of the self-negative thoughts, any of the self-negative emotions, any of the self-rejection. I am valuable, I am loved, and I am yours, Jesus. You heard that, devil. I command you to take your hands off her right now. Take your filthy hands off her body. Take your filthy hands off her mind. And take your filthy hands off her soul in Jesus' mighty name. Come out of her right now. Go. In Jesus' name, I break every yoke. I break every covenant with the enemy. In Jesus' name, I break every chain. I break the power of darkness. In Jesus' name, I break every covenant with Satan. Come out of her. In Jesus' name, come out of her. In the name of Jesus Christ, come out of her now. Go. Go now. In Jesus' name, come out of her. In the name of Jesus, come out of her. By the love of God, on the authority of God's word, come out of her, devil, now. In Jesus' name. You have no right. I command you to come out of her. Infirmity, diseases, curses, come out of her right now. In Jesus' name, go. I break that yoke right now. I break that spiritual tie right now in Jesus' name. I break that yoke in Jesus' name. I break every covenant with Satan in Jesus' name. Come out of her. Come out of her right now. In Jesus' name. Come out of her in the name of Jesus. Come out of her in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus Christ, I command you to go right now. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Have your way, Father. Have your way, Father. In Jesus' mighty name, disease, infirmity, come out right now.